February of 1967, the Bee Gees returned to England from Australia with the dream of becoming British pop stars. Within months, their new manager, Robert Stigwood, was making it happen.
It was all like a fantasy come true. The place that we'd left earlier was suddenly the place where we wanted to be, you know, professionally.
The first thing the Bee Gees needed to do was expand from a vocal trio to a proper rock band. They added two Australian musicians, Colin Peterson on drums and Vince Maloney on lead guitar.
In the event of something happening to me,
Stigwood wanted to promote the Bee Gees' debut as the next Beatles. Their first single was sent to American radio stations without their name on it.
Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones? Do you know what it's like on the outside?
It begins with a B and it finishes with an S. Who is it? And it was New York Mining Disaster. They kept playing it and playing it, and everybody thought it was the Beatles under a different name.
The trick worked, but it also led to the impression that the Bee Gees were Beatles imitators.
And then To Love Somebody came out, and they went, there must be a real Bee Gees.
To Love Somebody, a song written for Otis Redding, showed a more soulful side of the Bee Gees. The brothers' strength as R&B songwriters wasn't much needed in swinging London, but it would blossom in later years. Still teenagers, the Gibbs found themselves thrust into the height of London's jet set, sitting face to face with the biggest stars of pop music.
I was going to a party at this club called the Speakeasy. And I'd never heard of it before, but it was the club to be at. And the first person I met, actually, when I walked in was Otis Redding. And then it was Pete Townsend. And I went, whoa, this is getting heavy. And I remember looking at the stage, and I just heard Scotch and Coke, isn't it? And I turned around, and it was John. And I went, ah. But it was a great period for me, because only 2 months earlier, I was walking down Pitt Street in Sydney buying Beatle fan club books.
In the fall of 1967, the Bee Gees had their first English number one single with Massachusetts.
Feel I'm going back to Massachusetts. Something's telling me I must go home.
There was a crisis when the two non-Gibb band members, Vince and Colin, were almost forced out of the country. Being native Australians, their temporary visas had run out, and they were about to be deported. Once again, master media mind Robert Stigwood stepped in. He staged an assault on the immigration office. Bee Gees fans chained themselves to Buckingham Palace and picketed the Prime Minister's home. Eventually, the musicians were allowed to stay. Stigwood was the Bee Gees' godfather.
He was the first one to champion us when we got to the UK. And remember, in those days, there were thousands and thousands of groups, artists, trying to make it when we arrived in England. It was overwhelming. We met the right man at the right time, and he believed in us, and he was a very powerful man.
If I remember all of the things I have done.
As their popularity grew, the Bee Gees set out on a successful world tour and continued to release a steady stream of hits. In 16 months, the Bee Gees' lives changed completely. They made 3 albums and had 9 hit singles. They got famous, they got money, they got girls, and they got crazy.
I'm getting sick.
It was all great, but it was all too much. After the third Bee Gees album was released in the summer of 1968, guitarist Vince Maloney left the band. As the group entered the studio to begin work on their 4th album, tensions rose. Problems between the brothers emerged.
We were not friends anymore. We were still brothers, but we couldn't get along with each other.
The three brothers who had been inseparable all of their lives were now living on their own, with money to burn.
Everybody suddenly developed an ego, which hadn't happened before, you know.
All day,
and success sort of took its toll.
You feel as if the earth could fly.
It was just too much money too soon.
I had 6 Aston Martins and 7 Rolls Royces before I was 21. That's how quickly I went through that period. So I'll give you an idea of what it was like getting instant fame.
Drug experimentation only added to their problems. Everyone was popping pills in the business, Barry said. It became normal at that point.
It was the flower power period, and there wasn't anybody that you knew that wasn't on some form of drug.
Actually, what it was is that at one time Barry was smoking pot, Ron would be on pills, and I'd be drinking, so it'd be pilly potty and throughout the business.
Each brother had his own group of hangers-on, telling him he was the real star of the Bee Gees, and the British press got involved with the squabbling.
Oh, that was like an argument between, really between Barry and Robin. I was sort of in the middle, you know. And instead of talking to each other on the phone, they would talk to each other via the reporters, you know. So one would go back saying this about 1 week, and the next week the other one would answer him, whether he knew whether it was true or not.
The first time you become famous, I think, is a very dangerous time. You believe what people say about you. You believe your press.
Too much happened so fast that we lost kind of communication between the three of us. We found ourselves going on doing a show. There'd be a show booked in Los Angeles, and two of us would show up and the other one wouldn't, or one of us would leave and get on a plane and go home. It was just madness, really.
The arguments reached a head in March of 1969. Robin wanted the group's next single to be a song called Lamplight. Barry wanted First of May.
But guess who cried come First of May?
Barry won the argument. Robin quit the band. Although the group was still committed to their 5-year contract with Robert Stigwood, Robin was released and allowed to go solo. The Gibb family said Robin was out of control, indulging in drugs and spending too much money. Father Hugh Gibb took drastic measures and set out to make his 20-year-old son a ward of the court.
Not that he can ever do it, you know. I'm a married man, and I've got my own life. I'm carving my own career.
With their money stopped, Robin and his new wife, Molly, became even more isolated from the rest of the Gibb family.
Is Robin in any sense a prisoner in his own home?
No, it's ridiculous. I mean, he's perfectly free to go out and come in whenever he likes.
Now, his father, Mr. Gibb, is said to be concerned about Robin's welfare and his finances. Are you satisfied that everything's all right?
Of course I am. Otherwise, I wouldn't be behind Robin.
The Gibb family had splintered into factions. The brothers had stopped communicating. Robin was estranged from everyone.
I mean, it wasn't a good feeling. I can't explain it. It was like there was half of me was gone. Well, he's my twin, but there was that feeling that I'd never had before. That the other half of me's gone. Something's missing, you know.
Tomorrow. Everyone gonna know me, babe.
Barry, Morris, and Colin continued as the Bee Gees, with Sister Leslie filling in for Robin's vocal at one performance. The scaled-down version of the group appeared in Stigwood's slapstick comedy movie, Cucumber Castle.
My friend, my cucumber and I welcome you.
In the event of something happening to me.
While filming the movie, Colin had a falling out with Barry and Morris and was fired. By the end of 1969, Barry and Morris had called it quits as well.
I started a joke.
The 60s were over. And so everyone thought were the Bee Gees.
But I didn't see that the joke was on me.